Okay.
Let's go chapter two. Talk about chapter two a little bit. All right.
Atoms, molecules, and ions. Now we're going to start getting into
Chemistry. But as with all sciences, there is a history. Sometimes the history is beneficial and sometimes interferes. So we're just going to take it as it is and start with the earliest examples of what we would consider bona fide chemistry. And that came from the Greeks. The Greeks weren't big experimentalists. In other words, they tried to do everything in their heads. In fact, when they usually taught their young men, and this was before women got educated, they would you'd have to hold everything in your head, and the only time you could draw stuff as a student was maybe draw it in the sand with a stick for geometry, for instance. Right, everything was in their heads, and they just didn't do a whole lot of experimenting, not the way we would think of experimenting. So they had some pretty strange ideas, but a few of them took hold. One was the what their version of the atomic theory. You know, all matter is made of elementary parts, smallest possible parts that you can have. The problem was that they thought that all matter was made of the same atoms. Right. We found that wasn't true. And what that tells you is that if your theory is wrong and you run with it, sometimes you'll hit a brick wall. In other words, the theory won't answer your questions. But it did give a starting point for modern chemistry, and we'll get to that eventually. Then we went through the Dark Ages, Middle Ages with alchemists. And alchemists were either of one or both objectives. One possible objective was to find the elixir of life. And the other was to turn lead into gold, your classical alchemist joke. But they did do some things. In other words, they needed strong acids to dissolve some of the materials that they were using. So they managed to isolate the nitric acid, hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid. So that came from them through into the modern age. They also discovered several of the elements. But they didn't call them the same thing we did, that we do now. But they were bona fide elements, and we confirmed that with modern science, that what they had discovered was element. We'll define what an element is later. Then comes along Robert Boyle. He was considered the first experimental chemist. He was an Englishman, and he lived in the 17th century, I believe. And he actually performed what we would modern day we would consider experiments. In other words, ask a question, he'd propose an answer, which we call a hypothesis, and then he'd devise an experiment to test to see if his hypothesis was correct. And actually, he offered the first definition of an element. We'll get to that eventually. Then we move along and we get to a Frenchman. Lavoisier. He was an interesting character. He came up with this law of conservation of mass. And what that says is in a chemical reaction, you put a certain mass of your products together, and the total mass of the, excuse me, reactants, total mass of your reactants, when they finish their job, you account for all the products that come out of that reaction. It'll be exactly the same mass as the reactants. Lavoisier, though, did not live to a ripe old age. He had the misfortune of being both rich and a tax collector. And in those days, you bought a commission from the king to collect taxes. And the king said, I want this much of what you take, and the rest is yours. So tax collectors, a lot of them got were rightfully so maligned by most of the people, because they could take excess and keep what the king didn't want. I don't know if Lavoisier did that, but he suffered the consequences of being a tax collector when the French Revolution got rolling and the guillotine was starting to come into fashion. He lost his head. Okay, then there was Proust. Sounds like a French name, but he was really English. In fact, a lot of the English words we use in English now were derived from the French because of the Norman conquest. Right? The Normans were Vikings that were given parts of northern France so that they wouldn't attack Paris. And they adopted the culture and the language. So when they crossed the English Channel to conquer England, the Battle of Hastings was the definitive battle. They brought the language with them. And so a lot of our words in English are French derived. Anyway, Proust came up with this law, the law of definite proportion. And all it says was, now that we know what elements are, when we form compounds of those elements, two or more elements together will potentially form a compound, that once you identify the compound, its characteristics, various physical and chemical properties, then it doesn't matter where you get that. You can isolate it from the ore in the ground, or you can make it by a chemical reaction, or you can purify it from some other source. Once you've identified that compound, it will have the same exact composition of each of the elements in the compound, no matter what its source. That's the definite proportions of each of the elements in the compound. Right? Now, at this point, we're talking about laws. In other words, a law is simply a statement of fact. It doesn't make any attempt to explain why it happens, just that this is it. This is what happens. Does anybody in here have physics? Been introduced to Newton? No Isaac Newton? Nobody knows Isaac Newton? Okay. He's got three famous laws, laws of motion, Newton's laws of motion. And they make no claim to say why things happen. It's when we get to theories that we try to say why something happens. The progression has usually been all these different laws were developed, and then somebody got the bright idea to pull them all together and say, this is why these all happen. How they do that? I know why. And they propose a theory. We'll get to one in a second. Now, students usually have difficulty differentiating between the law of definite proportions and the law of multiple proportions. The only thing they have in common is proportions. Dalton proposed the law of multiple proportions. He was an Englishman. And basically what he says is, when you have what we call a homologous series of compounds, where you have two elements together in the compound, and I use the example of nitrogen and oxygen. If you have nitrogen together with oxygen, then these can occur, they can make different compounds. And we now know that it's the ratio of how many atoms of one to the other in the compound. So we would write it this way. Now, they didn't know it at the time, but this is my illustration. All right, so if we have it like this, then notice that we've got the same, say we have the same mass of nitrogen in as part of these compounds. Then that means that the mass of oxygen is going to be a certain amount. Right, say we have X mass of nitrogen. We're going to have Y amount of oxygen in this compound. In this compound, we're going to have 2Y. In this compound, we're going to have 3Y. Okay? So what that translates to in Dalton's law of multiple proportions is that in a series of compounds with two elements, if you can identify the same mass of one element. And the other elements from one compound to the next are going to be whole number multiples of each other. That's the multiple proportions. Okay, that's all that says. Now, Dalton's going to come along and explain why this is at some point. He's also going to take those other laws we've looked at and explain why they happen too. So Dalton's is the key to all of these laws that we've just looked at. And he did it with what he called the atomic theory, right? So he went back to the ancient Greeks and borrowed or stole, whichever you prefer, stole their idea of the atom. The atom being the simplest particle of any matter. You could have a pure element and it's made up of atoms. And you could keep cutting it in half, theoretically, until you get down to one atom. Now, the solution to the Greeks' problem that Dalton proposed was that you get down to this simplest atom, but the atom of this element is different than the atom of that element. That solved the problem. See, the Greeks, they had to do mental gyrations to make their single type of atom do everything that we see in nature. So they invented these elementary forces, water, fire, wind, and earth, I think. So since they were not experimenters, they couldn't test their theories anyway. Okay, so that was the first thing. First point of Dalton's atomic theory is each element is made of tiny particles called atoms, and that each of the atoms for an element are identical, but for different elements, they're not the same atoms. And then we form compounds from combinations of these atoms. Right? Now we're not just talking about mass relationships, we're talking about numbers. Numbers of different elements combine in certain ways to make compounds. He also said that when we react, one reactant with another, then we get products. And the reason we get the same mass of product as the mass of the reactants is because you haven't created or destroyed any of the atoms. All the atoms are still there. So you got the same mass going in and it's coming out. They just rearrange, they switch dance partners. That's all there is to it, a chemical reaction. Okay. Then along comes, see, that was in the late 18th century, mid to late 18th century. We're just into the 19th century, and now we've got two researchers, Avogadro, who's Italian, Amedeo Avogadro, and Gay-Lussac, that's a hyphenated last name. And they were working with gases and chemical reactions. Let's go to Avogadro first. Now, what Avogadro said was essentially that, and we're working with gases here because they're easier to deal with, apparently. If you have two volumes of gases, and it doesn't matter what the gases are, they could be the same gas, they could be different gases. If the volumes, this one equals the volume of that one, okay, in this container, and the temperature of this one is equal to the temperature of that one. And we measure the pressure inside, whatever units you want to use. The pressure inside is equal for both of them. Then what Avogadro said was, it must follow that, this is my abbreviation, the numbers of molecules, atoms, whatever individual actors are in here, numbers of particles in this container equals the numbers of particles in that container. Okay. That was a earth-shaking, groundbreaking proposal that solved a massive problem that chemists both in industry and university were having, particularly in Europe, in the mid-19th century. And Avogadro worked on this at the beginning of the 19th century, so I don't even know if he was alive when his theory was put to use. But he and Gay-Lussac based his work on Avogadro's hypothesis. And Gay-Lussac was looking at the relationship of gases during chemical reactions under the same conditions of temperature and pressure were equal. So he was watching the changes of volume before and after a reaction relative to the numbers of particles that were there. Okay, this is what Gay-Lussac would say. He has two volumes of hydrogen and one volume of oxygen. And if they react completely, they will produce two volumes of water vapor. Right? So in chemistry, 1 + 1 doesn't always equal 2. And in this case, 2 + 1 doesn't equal 3. Right? So we need Avogadro's hypothesis to explain why that is. What we find is that the number of particles in that oxygen cube is exactly half of the number of particles in the hydrogen cube. And when we look at the reaction between, and we haven't done this yet, but I'm going to tease you a little. If we look at the reaction between hydrogen gas and oxygen gas, it will produce water, in this case, a gas. The ratios of the numbers tell us that that ratio. So two volumes of hydrogen, one volume of oxygen yields two volumes of water. That's why it happens. That's why those ratios of volumes are there, based upon Avogadro's hypothesis. Now, they're not the same volumes. They're different volumes, but they ratio by whole number factors based upon the chemical reaction itself. Okay, we'll get into this in more detail. So, and this is probably ancient Greek to you at this point. But what we're doing is over time, what's the saying, we stand on the shoulders of giants? These people, these scientists are working through problems and creating useful information that can be tested by others to see if it's true. It's called peer review. Your peers are watching you and you're watching them to keep everybody honest so that we can develop what we would consider truth, knowledge, and slough off the stuff that's worthless. There used to be a theory in the first inklings of modern science called the phlogiston theory. And not to get into too much detail, it tried to explain chemical reactions in terms of this undefined stuff that was exchanged during the reaction. And eventually, other scientists they either agreed with them or disagreed with them, but some of them experimented and disproved that theory. So now you don't even hear it unless somebody with historical knowledge tells you about it, right? It's worthless. It's gone. And I'll point out another place where wrong theories were discarded, right, later. Now, in this case, when we react hydrogen and chlorine, we do get 1 + 1 = 2. But the reason is the ratio of numbers of particles that we start with and the numbers we end with. This is a diagram of making water. What we can also say is definite proportions tells us that water could come from this reaction. Or we could distill water from some source and get pure water. And after you've gone through that process, if you just have this container of water from that process and this container from distillation, you can't tell where they came from. They're identical. Let's skip that. Okay. So now, as part of this study of history, we're developing an understanding of what the microscopic world looks like in chemistry. Why does what we observe happen the way it does? It's because there's something happening that we can't see. So it would be helpful, right, if you were to develop an intuition of going from a macroscopic world to microscopic. Always ask yourself, all right, I observed that gas formation. You know, why? Where did it come from? Some microscopic process is producing that gas. And then you can think in terms of chemical reactions. Okay, now along comes J.J. Thompson toward the end of the 19th century. And not just chemists, but what do they call them? Natural philosophers was the term. They were rich folks who had enough money and time and energy that could investigate natural processes. And they weren't really confined to any one field. So you could find chemistry and physics and all that just jumbled together with these people that were working on. J.J. Thompson was taking note of the study of electricity, which was becoming popular. Now, you could study it scientifically or you could use it for a party. Right? They had these parties and they knew how to generate static electricity with these devices. Right? If you were wealthy enough, you could device and you crank it up and it would collect an excess of charge on the surface of the sphere. And then what you would do is everybody would hold hands and then the one person next to the sphere would touch it and everybody would jump and they'd have a big high old time and drink some more wine. But J.J. Thompson wanted to know what that electricity was caused by. And he was interested in types of electricity. We knew that there was a difference. There was you would call positive and negative charges. And he was interested in the negative charge. What was the nature of that negative charge? And he used a cathode ray tube, right? Everybody's got flat screens now, but it used to be computers had these big old bulky boxes on top of the computer called cathode ray tubes, CRT screens. Right? You probably don't remember those. Some TVs are like that. Until a couple of years ago, I still had one in my house. It finally crapped out and I had to throw it out. But it essentially fired electrons from an electron gun at a screen in front, a glass plate that was coated with phosphors, a reactive material. So when the electron hit it, it would light up. And these simple cathode ray tubes could be used to test what is that particle that's being transferred from one electrode to the other inside this evacuated tube. Well, Thompson proposed, based upon his experimentation, that the particle that was being transferred from one electrode to the other was negatively charged. And he wanted more information about it. Now, the technology, often scientific advancements don't happen until you have the right technology to go with them. So the technology at that time didn't allow him to do anything but measure the ratio of the mass of this particle to its charge. So he did come up with that value. And he also made the observation that these electrical charges were originating from atoms. Right? Everybody already accepted Dalton's theory. And they were basing their research upon that, said, okay, they got to come from somewhere. And if they're not out here just floating around and we grab them, then they got to come from some neutral source. So they come from atoms. So he knew that much. So there's an example of his cathode ray tube.
Cathode rays are produced in a discharge tube. A vacuum pump is used to evacuate the discharge tube. The cathode of the tube is connected to the negative terminal of the battery, and the anode of the tube is connected to the positive terminal of the battery. It was observed that, at normal pressure, the gas did not allow the current to pass through it. However, when the pressure of the tube was reduced to 0.001 mmHg, and a high potential difference between 10 kV and 20 kV was applied, at the end of the tube, a glow was seen on the walls of glass tube. The rays emitted by the cathode travel towards anode. The attraction of rays towards anode reveals that the rays carry negative charge. Properties of cathode rays are: 1. When any object is placed in the path of the cathode rays, these rays cast shadows. This shows that cathode rays travel in straight line. 2. When a wheel was placed in the path of cathode rays, the wheel rotates. This shows that rays consist of some particle and some kinetic energy. 3. In the presence of an electric field, the rays are deflected towards the positive plate. This confirms that cathode rays consist of negatively charged particles. 4. In the presence of a magnetic field, the rays are deflected. This shows that the cathode rays are affected by the magnetic field.
What I'll do is I'll take the original video, and when I process the recording, I'll insert the original in there so it'll be a little better quality. But notice when the magnet was placed over that cathode ray, they had a bending toward the magnet to do that. In the magnetic field, it bends perpendicular to the magnet field.
A minor detail.
Okay, so we know that part of the atom is made up of these negatively charged particles that are called electrons. Well, a few years later, a rather interesting character and a very smart character, an experimental chemist called Robert Millikan, who was an American, but this time we start to get involved in sciences, devised an experiment that he hoped would allow him to determine the mass of these particles. So I've got another video following this one, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail. But the magnitude of the charge was determined, and this is in unit coulombs. Coulombs is in honor of a French scientist who worked with electricity. So he found that the elementary charge of an electron was this many coulombs. And he used that charge that he determined in his experiments, along with J.J. Thompson's mass charge ratio, to calculate the mass of an electron. And he came extremely close. He was very meticulous in his work. He came very close to what we consider the modern value for the mass of an electron. And he got a Nobel Prize for his work, Nobel Prize in Physics. Actually, he got the Nobel Prize not for this work, but for some other work where he experimentally confirmed Einstein's photoelectric equation. Now, Einstein had a couple years earlier received the Nobel Prize for his work on photoelectric effect. He explained it. And then Millikan confirmed experimentally, and he got a Nobel for that.
That's back when Nobel Prizes actually meant something.
Now that you do have a Nobel Prize, or president of the Prize, Obama got a Peace Prize for what? Nothing. You can do anything for it.
Anyway, so now the Nobel Prize is all identical. The following video is overly simplified, useful explanation of Millikan's work. Okay, so let's take a look at this. Let's get going.
In a series of experiments carried out between 1908 and 1917, R.A. Millikan succeeded in measuring the charge of the electron with great precision. In his experiment, a fine mist of oil was sprayed into the upper chamber with an atomizer. Some of the tiny oil droplets fell through the hole in the upper floor, and Millikan was able to determine the mass of an oil drop from its terminal velocity. Next, Millikan used an X-ray source to ionize gas molecules in the chamber. Electrons from this ionization process adhered to the oil droplets. The oil droplets now carry a negative charge. The negatively charged oil droplets can be halted by adjusting the voltage across the two plates. As the voltage across the plates is increased, the velocity of the oil drops slows. As the voltage is increased further, some drops will begin to move upward toward the positive plate. If the voltage is set just right, an oil drop can be suspended. When an oil drop is suspended, its weight, mass times acceleration due to gravity, is exactly counterbalanced by the electric force applied. The electric force applied equals the applied electric field, E, times the charge on the drop, Q. Since the mass of the oil drop, the acceleration due to gravity, and the applied electric field are known, Millikan could solve for Q, which is the charge on the drop. Millikan found that droplets had different charges, but each was a whole number multiple of a smaller charge, equal to negative 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19th coulombs. Millikan concluded that this was the fundamental unit of charge, the charge of an electron. From the charge of an electron and the charge-to-mass ratio of an electron determined by Thomson using a cathode ray tube, Millikan was able to calculate the mass of an electron. The mass of an electron, 9.10 times 10 to the negative 28th grams, is an exceedingly small mass.
Okay, so that is an oversimplified version, but he built his own equipment so that he could do this experiment. And he had this microscope on the side through a port, and he could watch the drops move and adjust. He did this experiment. He and his graduate students, this is experiment over and over thousands of times to eliminate as much experimental error as possible. All right. Okay, so now we know that from the atom, you can get an electron, right? The negatively charged. Well, we also know that atoms are neutral. So there has to be an equal positive charge in there also. There's another particle in there that perfectly balances that charge. Except that with that such a small mass of that particle, it doesn't account for even the smallest fraction of the mass of an atom. So we knew that the mass of the atom had to be related to the other particle primarily. Okay, so now Henri Becquerel, who was French, was working in an area in the late 19th century that was becoming popular, radioactivity. Right? People like Marie Curie were involved also. In fact, they didn't understand the dangers of radioactivity, and Marie Curie and her husband both died at relatively young ages from cancers. Anyway, these three particles were identified. There are many more than this, but these are the three major ones at this time that were understood, were the emitted from radioactive sources. And what we mean by radioactive is these elements are unstable and they decay into other elements. And when they do, they very often release different types of radiation. Now, gamma radiation is simply high energy light, very high energy. In fact, the highest energy light that we've ever encountered in the universe can come from a decay. Beta particles can come from a decay. What we've identified as a beta particle is actually a high speed electron. And then alpha particles can also come. And alpha particles are helium nuclei. So you have the helium atom, and if you strip its electrons off of it, and it only has two, right? Hydrogen has one, helium has two electrons. You strip the electrons off of it, then you've removed two negative charges
And that leaves the two positive pions. So that's why the alpha particle is a helium nucleus. Only it originates from the nucleus of a larger atom. Okay, so I said all that because the alpha particles are going to be used by another scientist to test a theory he has about the structure of the atom.
Let's see, here we go. And that's Ernest Rutherford.
He was an Englishman. And there were various theories floating around about how atoms are constructed. What are they made of? Right. They knew that there had to be a positive particle in there, along with a negative particle, to account for the mass and the charge at the same time. So other people had worked on and discovered the proton, right? That carries the positive charge. But they didn't know how the atom was constructed. One theory was what was called the plum pudding model. You ever had plum pudding before? It's not bad. There's little pieces of plum scattered throughout a pudding. And the reason they called it the plum pudding model was they thought the atom was made up of this positively charged pudding with negative electron particles scattered throughout. Okay. So the plum pudding model could be tested. Rutherford said, no, I think the atom, this is his hypothesis, I think the atom is nuclear. That is, it has a very, very dense central part right here. Right? That's where the protons reside. And then out here is mostly empty space with our electrons. And since the electrons have such little mass, if you fire some heavy particle through there, it should not be deflected if it passes through this part. If it passes through this part, then it would be slowed down, but there would be no deflection because there weren't any massive particles to get in the way because this positive charge is spread throughout the pudding. But Rutherford said, no, those particles are real. Those protons are real. They live in the nucleus, very dense nucleus. And then the rest of this is mostly space with electrons out there. All right, so this is how he devised his way to test his theories. Okay. He knew how to work with alpha particles, a radioactive source that emitted alpha particles. Right? So he used those heavy particles and fired them through as thin a matrix as he could get. And they were very good in those days, as they still are, at hammering gold into very thin sheets. Gold will hold together and it'd be maybe 3 or 4 atoms thick. So when they recovered the Capitol down in Charleston, it didn't take much gold, really. They just hammered it so thin, maybe, I don't know, 5 or 6 ounces would probably be enough to cover the whole roof. But he wanted a thin sheet because he knew if he had a thick sheet of anything, that there would be the probability of hitting something solid would completely stop his beam, right? Nothing would pass through it. So he wanted a very thin sheet, and he used gold, right? So I've got a video that sort of describes that for us. Here we go. Is it going to start on its own? Maybe not. Oh, this one's not narrated. Okay, so there's the apparatus. There's the alpha particle emitter, and it's lead shielded, and it's open at one end so the particles can get out. And then you need a way to collimate the beam. In other words, make the beam straight because the particle's going every which way. So usually the way you do that is you put a pinhole here and a pinhole here, and only the ones that are traveling straight will go through both of them. So here come the alpha particles. I can't remember what he used as his source. But these helium nuclei are being fired through the collimator. Right? So now we straighten them out. Now we're going to go into the instrument and impact the gold foil. Right? So what would happen if the plum pudding model were correct? Then the beam would go straight through and everything would be in a fine spot on the other side. But this is what we got. We got most of it coming through straight, and then some of it being deflected. So there are the electrons in the yellow, and the orange in the middle is the nucleus. Electrons are not going to stop anything. But once you get close to that nucleus, you can be deflected or even bounced almost straight back because it's very, very heavy. And gold is an extremely heavy atom. So it was a good choice as your target.
Okay.
So now we're building up a picture of how the atom is, what it's made of, and how it's constructed. I think we've already seen that. So now we know that the atom is made of electrons and protons, and the protons are in the nucleus, and the electrons are out here in some kind of whatever we don't know yet. But Rutherford also understood that even though the protons are very massive, they alone do not account for all the mass of the atom. There has to be another particle in there, and it cannot have a charge, because the charge has already been neutralized by the electrons. So there has to be a particle in there with no charge and significant mass. So he set one of his students, I don't know if he was a graduate student or a research associate, maybe he already had his degree. Anyway, his name was Chadwick, James Chadwick. And he set to work and discovered where all that mass resided. I don't have the particulars on the experiments right now, but it must have impressed somebody because he got a Nobel Prize for it in 1935 for discovering the neutron. So now we know the atom is made up of a nucleus with nearly all the mass composed of protons and neutrons, and then electrons in the out here. Okay, I've already said that. That's just an illustration of the difference in size. So have you ever heard the expression orders of magnitude? Orders of magnitude refers to a number times 10, you know, exponential notation, something times 10 to the power. Seen that? Okay. Orders of magnitude is powers of 10. So if there's a difference here from minus 13 up to minus 8, which would be bigger, right? That's a difference of 5 orders of magnitude. You stepped 5 powers of 10 from minus 13 to minus 8. So we've increased the size of the atom from the size of the nucleus 5 orders of magnitude. That's a big jump. Okay. Dalton said that in his atomic theory that all the atoms of an element are exactly the same. And in one respect, he's 99.99% correct. Their chemical reactivity is the same. But they're not the same because we know that some atoms differ in their mass. Some atoms of the same element differ in their mass. We call those isotopes. And now we know why they're different in mass. Now, an atom of an element is defined by the number of protons in its nucleus. So if you have the same number of protons in this nucleus and that nucleus, they are exactly the same element. But if they're different mass, where does that mass come from? Well, you can't change the protons or you change the element. So the difference has to come in neutrons. So this isotope has the same protons as this one, but different numbers of neutrons. So, all naturally occurring elements are a mixture of isotopes. In other words, we haven't found a single element that is composed of exactly the same, all the same isotopes. Now, usually, there's one isotope that's by far the most abundant. There are a couple of exceptions. But most of them, one isotope is more stable than the rest of them. It dominates. So for this example, sodium, I guess this is, there's another slide on it, but I'm going to do it here. If we say this is the symbol, right, just any symbol for the element, then there are four positions around that element that are reserved for information. And everybody, all scientists know it. In this position, we've got what's called the Z, atomic number. That's the number of protons. So in the case of sodium, it would be 11. Okay. If you know this, you know what that should be. And if you know that, you know what that is. All you have to do is look at your periodic table and find it. This one up here is the mass number. And the mass number, let's see, this is protons. The mass number is the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. Okay? So if you want to know the number of neutrons in that isotope, you just subtract this one from that one, and what's left is the number of neutrons. Okay? This position is reserved for charge. If there's nothing there, you assume it's neutral. Or you can write a zero like I did for this one. That means it's neutral. If it has a charge, then you'll put a 1 plus, 2 plus, 3 plus, or 1 minus, 2 minus, 3 minus, whatever the charge happens to be. And then you have an ion. And in this position, you have the number of atoms. So if you're trying to express this as an atom, this will tell you how many of them there are. And those positions are reserved. Now, in chemistry, most of the time, we don't care about isotopes. So when we write a chemical reaction, we just leave those out. We got a symbol. If it's got a charge, fine. If it doesn't, leave it out. If we need to know the numbers of those, for instance, if we write water again, that just means there are two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom together. Okay. Because of that position. Okay. And there's the slide. And that's one of the reasons I want you to learn the symbols. It's because if you know the symbol and the element that it represents, you can always go to the periodic table and find the atomic number, the Z value. That tells you the number of protons. Now, it'll be in different positions in different tables, but it's always a whole number. I'll explain why these are fractions later. All right. So I didn't give you the question before I gave you the answer. If you have an isotope that contains 23 protons and 28 neutrons, the mass number is 51. You just add them together. What element is that? Looks like vanadium, right? 23 protons. Look on the periodic table. It goes from top to bottom, left to right, increasing values of atomic number. So we find 23 protons, that's vanadium. So our element is vanadium. Okay. I don't know if I had your, I think I did have you memorize that one. Have you started memorizing yet? How to get your 3x5 cards and write out the symbols and flip them over and write the name and just drill them until you can do it in your sleep. It's kind of like, I don't know, learning a foreign language. Do you still have to learn a foreign language in school? Okay. So there comes a point where you start dreaming in that language. Then you know you're on your way. And of course, in all my dreams, let's see, I took French in school. In all my dreams, when I spoke in French in my dreams, it was perfect. Accent, everything was spot on. That's the advantage of dreams. Okay. Now, if we're going to have compounds formed, we have to know what holds those atoms together, because that determines the individual unit that we call the compound. Sometimes atoms are bound together by sharing electrons. And sometimes they actually transfer one or more electrons from one atom to the next. That's the easiest one to understand. Actually, I don't know why I put covalent first. But the ionic bond is the easiest one to understand because you've got one atom transfers one or more electrons to the other one, and then the thing that holds them together is opposite charges. It's electrostatic. A good example is sodium and chlorine. So if we transfer an electron, chlorine likes electrons more than sodium does. So if it transfers an electron over here, now we're deficient in electrons. When you create an ion, you either add or subtract electrons. Can't mess with the protons. Remember why? You change the number of protons, you don't have the same element, right? So you have to make your ions with electron transfers, either add or subtract electrons, and that gives you an imbalance. If you start off neutral and you take away a negative, that leaves you with a positive, doesn't it? One positive. Now we're going to add this negative to that chlorine. That makes it negative then. So now you have an attraction, an electrostatic attraction between the two. And what you have is table salt, sodium chloride. We'll talk about naming compounds later. That's an ionic bond. Covalent bonds, and these usually form between metals and nonmetals. And we have to talk about that too, the periodic table. Metals are mostly, see that jagged line? These are nonmetals, those are metals. So if you form a bond between a metal and a nonmetal, it's usually ionic. If you form a bond between two nonmetals, then it's going to be covalent. They have to share electrons simply because neither one has enough attractive force for electrons to steal from the other one. So they compromise. They share the electrons. And eventually we're going to find out why they do that. But for now, it's just a matter of memory. And when the covalent bonds are formed, we form molecules. In other words, units of a collection of atoms. And in this case, a molecule can be all the same element, all the same atoms. H2 is a molecule. Right? H2O is a molecule of water. This is a molecule of hydrogen. This is a compound, and that's not. But they're both bound by covalent bonds. They share electrons among the atoms in order to form those bonds. Now, for these ionic compounds, they actually don't exist as discrete units. Like H2O, that water molecule acts as a separate player. But when you have sodium and chloride together, they form a matrix of positive and negative charges. So I ask my students this every year or every semester. If you've ever spilled salt on a table and looked at it with a magnifying glass, most of them haven't. Occasionally I'll get one who does. If you do, what do you see? You see little tiny cubes. That's a macroscopic manifestation of the microscopic arrangement of ions. So you get them in this network. This sodium is surrounded by chloride ions. And in front and back, too. And the ratio is 1:1. Right? You may have a billion sodium ions and a billion chloride ions in that cube. But there's still a ratio of 1:1. That's why we write it this way in ACL. But they don't form discrete molecules. They form an ionic matrix. And we'll talk about that more later also. Okay. Now, these are ions, sodium ion, chloride ion. But we also have names for whether they're positive or negative. The positive ions are called cations. And the negative ions are called anions. Just memorize. Oh, we're done? No, I'm not. Oh, I've got a video I forgot about.
So this is a video that addresses the question that students often have. What is the difference between a formula unit and a molecular formula? And that brings up a couple of questions itself. What are the structural differences between ionic and molecular compounds? And how do those differences affect their chemical formulas? So the chemical formula for a covalent compound is a molecular formula. And the chemical formula for an ionic compound is called a formula unit. So an example of a molecular formula, H2O, which is water, and for a formula unit, NaCl, the formula unit of common table salt. So what's the diff? And if we look at the structure visually, I think we can see very much what the difference is. So let's first look at sodium chloride. This will be our example ionic compound. NaCl does not exist as a single unit, like a molecule, and this goes for all ionic compounds. So this would not be a valid way to represent sodium chloride. And like any ionic compound, in the solid state, sodium chloride exists as a crystal. So a very, 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 very tiny crystal would look like this with alternating sodium and chloride, and a little bit of a different view. The formula unit is NaCl, but if we look inside the crystal, the sodium and chloride ions are actually bonded to six oppositely charged neighbors. So if we shrink the ions, we can take a better look inside, and it's a little bit hard to see. So what we're going to do is take a look at a particular chloride ion, that one right there, and ask the question, how many sodium ions is the chloride ion close enough to bond with? Let's start with the head-on view first, and as we change the perspective, you can see there are exactly six sodium ions that the chloride ions is equidistant and can bond to. If we ask the same question of sodium, how many chloride ions can it bond to? Well, again, there are six chloride ions that it's equidistant to, and therefore the sodium ion also bonds to six chloride ions. So as you go throughout the crystal, you can see that is always the case. Because each sodium is bonded to more than one chloride ion, and each chloride ion is bonded to more than one sodium ion, then you can think of all the ions in the whole crystal part of one single bonded unit. And the crystal below would be Na32Cl32. So you can imagine that would be very impractical given the enormous numbers of ions in a crystal large enough to see with our eyes. So only the ratio of ions is given, and that would be its empirical formula. But we call the empirical formula of an ionic compound the formula unit. And sodium chloride is the formula unit for the sodium chloride crystal, and it is the smallest whole number ratio of sodium and chloride ions in the crystal. So all formula units are the smallest whole number ratio of the ions in the crystal. That goes for all formula units. Here's another example, calcium fluoride. You've got one calcium for every two fluorides. The calcium is 2+, the fluoride is 1-. It has a slightly different crystal structure to account for. Rather than the 1-to-1 ratio of sodium chloride, you have a 1-to-2 ratio of calcium fluoride. And if we shrink the atoms to take a better look, and see how the calcium is connected to the fluorides, you can see that each calcium has eight nearest fluoride neighbors, and so it is equally bonded to those eight fluoride neighbors. And if we look at the fluorine, each fluoride has four closest calcium neighbors. And again, like sodium chloride, the whole crystal acts as one single bonded unit, and so we need to express the formula as the lowest whole number ratio being CaF2. So what about molecules? How are they different? Let's take a look at water. We've got the space-filling model on the left, ball and stick model on the right. It's covalently bonded hydrogen and oxygen. And a collection of water molecules is just that, a collection of individual units of H2O that are covalently bonded single units of two hydrogens and one oxygen. They're not connected to each other except by weak forces. And so large amounts of H2O, any attraction between the water molecules due to weak forces, the molecules behave, they still behave as individual units, not one large bonded unit, as in an ionic crystal. Another view of water, here the hydrogens are white instead of yellow. And this I'm showing you to contrast more specifically with the sodium chloride or the calcium fluoride because we showed the ionic crystals as solids. And here's water as a solid, ice, of course. And here, like ionic compounds, molecular compounds also form crystals in the solid state, a very ordered structure that you can see here. If we take a closer look, however, we can see that each H2O remains as a single unit and is not covalently bonded to any other H2O. The attractions that hold them in place are, of course, the very, very strong dipole, the hydrogen bonding that occurs between the hydrogen and the oxygen. But that is much, much, much weaker than the covalent bond between the hydrogen and the oxygen, and the H2O therefore remains a single unit. So we look at these structural differences between molecules and ionic compounds by how we express them in their formulas. The molecule is represented by a molecular formula showing all the atoms present in the unit. The ionic compound is represented by the ratio of its ions, and that is called a formula unit. So here's the H2O molecule, and here versus the NaCl formula unit. Many sodiums and many chlorides, yet it's still just expressed as the lowest whole number ratio, one sodium to one chloride. In summary, in a molecule, the atoms given by the formula are all covalently bonded. In a collection of those molecules are attracted to each other by weak forces, but no covalent bonds occur between the molecules. The molecules exist as individual units of covalently bonded atoms. But in an ionic compound where the bond is the electrostatic attraction between oppositely charged ions, each ion is bonded to each of its oppositely charged neighbors. So for any ionic compound, all the ions in the whole crystal can be thought of as part of one single bonded unit. So the formula unit shows the lowest whole number ratio of the ions rather than representing very awkwardly all the ions in the crystal, which in most cases would be impossible to determine anyway. So that is the difference between a formula unit and a molecular formula.
All right. I'm about out of time.
What I've got here is lab documents. Give you the syllabus already. And we'll have to talk about some of these next time we meet. But if you want to, you can take a copy with you. And then if for some reason, because we're not going to have a hands-on lab next time, if for some reason you can't make it, then we'll have the hard copy already. And when you zoom in, you'll be able to reference it. So I'm going to leave these out. Also, you'll need to, there's an extra graph paper that you might need. Lost my train of thought. Oh, lab notebooks. Does anybody look for a lab notebook and got one?
That's Walmart.
Yeah, that's the Walmart version.
And they have this one and then one with just dots, and then they also have one that has the spiral thing.
That's the kind you want right there. Yeah. I have some of those if you want to save yourself a trip to Walmart. 225. I just rounded off to 2 1/4.
Yeah.
And I have several with me. And if that's not enough, I've got more. So just take one on each one of these. When you leave, if you have to leave now, fine. If you have to leave now, then you probably want your notebook now. So
Reality work to come.
you have work.
Yeah, I left
Okay.
work to come here.
Oh, okay. Does anybody need one?
I
Need one. Okay.
You can pay me later if you want.
Anybody else? No? Okay. All right. So, like I said, yeah, just.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah,
I'll bring it to
you
today. Okay. And a quick question. You said the table of contents. Do we need to take like two pages or something for the table of contents or just one?
One's going to be enough. Yeah. You won't need two pages. And remember, you only write on the right hand side. Odd number pages. Right hand pages are all odd numbered. Left hand pages are even numbered. All right. You're going to say, let's say one here,
yep.
And then second page, two here, three there, all the way to the end.
Do we count the table of contents pages, page one?
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So if you have to go ahead. We're not too far from the end, but we're not finished yet. So if we say a certain isotope is X plus, that is, it's the symbol with a plus, that means it's an ion. So it contains, and we're told it contains 54 electrons and 78 neutrons. What's the mass of this isotope?
Well,
if we have 54 electrons and 78 neutrons,
54 electrons. Oh, let me turn the lights back on.
It's what, 78 neutrons. Okay. So what's that number going to be? Well, it's deficient in one electron, isn't it? This is 54 electrons, how many would it be if it were neutral? 55 electrons, wouldn't it? Because if we take an electron away, then we get that one positive charge. And if we have all the electrons there to neutralize it, that means we need one more. And that's equal to 55 protons. Right? 5 protons. And then 55 plus 78 is 133, right? Okay, so the mass number is 133. Now, it doesn't ask you what element it is, but we can determine what element it is. Just look on the chart. 55, right over there, cesium. This is cesium. Okay. So which of the following statements regarding Dalton's atomic theory is still believed to be true? Okay, elements are made of tiny particles called atoms. Yep, that still holds water. All atoms of a given element are identical. Isotopes. Chemically, they're very similar, but even chemically, there are slight differences. So two is false. Three, a given compound always has the same relative number and types of atoms. Yeah, that's still true. Atoms are indestructible. No. We can, I mean, with the first example was the cathode ray tube. We're extracting electrons from the atoms. Okay, so the only two that are still true are those right there. Now we can talk about periodic table. It's divided into sections, and then we're going to drill down to individual specific information. But we can divide the table into sections. Metals versus nonmetals is the largest division. And that on this chart is designated by this stair step line. Now, in your extra credit exercise, I tell you to draw that line in black. So all you have to do is just copy that line. Groups or families. When I was younger, we learned them as families, but now they call them groups.
And the groups are vertical arrangements. We call them families or groups because they have similar chemical behaviors. So all the halogens behave similarly. They're not exact, but they're kissing cousins. All the oxygen family, these are halogens. Of course, these are noble gases, but they don't play with anybody. These are chalcogens, the oxygen group. These are nictogens, starts with a P. P is silent. This is the carbon group, the boron group. Over here, this first column are the alkaline metals, right? And hydrogen's not a metal, so we just put it over here for balance. But this is a metal, alkaline metals. These are alkaline earths. So those are groups that have names. Not all of them have names, but some of them do. And then that's the vertical. The horizontal are called periods. If you had physics, you'd learn a type of motion called periodic motion. Think of a grandfather clock with a pendulum, like swinging back and forth. It's moving. Yep. It's not going anywhere. It goes out here, goes back, and it comes back to here. That's a one period. It goes back and comes back to where it was. So that's how we think of these periods. Right? You go from left to right, and then you wrap back around and start over again. That's a period. Now, there's a reason for that that we're not going to get into right now, but that's the way the chart is arranged. They have groups and periods. And there's a... That actually gives you another one that we haven't mentioned yet. Transition metals. These are all metals, and they transition from that side to this side. Very original. One that's not given there, often you'll see it in your textbook, may say this. These and these are known as representative elements. So if you read that in a problem, it says of the representative elements, blah, 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 that's what they mean. And then these two partial periods down here are named after the origin of their group. So this one, all of these are stuffed in that place right there. See, it goes from 57 to 72. So it goes 57, 58, 71, and 72. These are pulled out for two reasons. One is it keeps the chart from being this long. The other is, and we haven't got into it yet, the way that the atoms are built when we add protons and add electrons to keep the things neutral are similar for this group and this group and different than these. So it's pulled out. And these are called lanthanides. These are called actinides because this is actinium. Okay. Another thing about some of these, especially the representative elements, they typically, when they're combined metals with nonmetals, they typically form standard ions, right? The standard charge on the ion. First group always forms positive one ions. Second group always forms positive two ions. Okay. These, down to about here, I think tellurium is absent. But these always form plus three ions. Then the carbon group is kind of in the middle. It can go either way. So we start back over this way. These don't form ions, typically. I mean, we can force them, but normally they don't. The halogens form a minus one charge. Right? When they're in an ionic compound, they form a minus one charge. Oxygen group, chalcogens, they generally form a minus two charge. See them going from one, two, three, one, two, three. And minus one, minus two, nitrogens are minus three. And then the carbons, the carbon group, that can go either way. So we can't nail them down. It's important to know that relationship when we start naming compounds, because the rules depend upon that characteristic of those groups. And that's what we've got here in this chart. It tells you the same thing. Now, when it says 1A, 2A, 7A, 8A, this table is set up with the modern numbering for the groups from left to right, 1 to 18. When I was a student, we learned that the representative elements, this was, in fact, we used Roman numerals. This is Roman numeral 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And what that told you was how many electrons were in the outermost shell. The valence electrons, and we'll talk about that later. But that system gave us more information. So the alkali metals have one in their outermost shell, and they just soon get rid of it. So get rid of that electron and plus one charge. The second one, alkaline earths, they had two electrons in their outermost shell. They get rid of those two. Now they're two plus charge. The halogens, this is Roman numeral 7, right? They want one more to make that octet. Have you ever heard of the octet? No? Biology? Okay, that's all right. We'll talk about it again. They want 8. So they've got 7. They'll take one more. It's like, no, I'm going to take it from that guy over there. And the noble gases, of course, are 8. They're perfect. They don't want any more. They don't want to give any up. They don't want any. Okay. Speaking of naming compounds, nomenclature is absolutely essential. Actually, you are going to need nomenclature.
Short change there of the group, I think. Yeah, sure is. All right.
Well, we'll tell them about it next coming meeting.
This is another extra credit. You have two extra credits in this
exam material.
This is an exercise name company, and we won't make any sense until we finish this lecture.
But it's worth doing.
All right.
We need to know how to name compounds, because if we're going to talk to each other about these types of things, chemical things, we need to agree upon naming our substances. And this is one of the places we start. After we learn how to name the elements and know their symbols, then we got to put them together into compounds and give them names. There are two requirements for names that the subcommittee of this overreaching group, IUPAC, International Union of Pure and Applied Chemists, they have a subcommittee that's devoted to nothing but naming compounds. And they came up with these rules. And for one thing, the name of a compound has to be unique. That is unambiguous. What we mean by that is, when we have a compound written, we need to name it in such a way that that name belongs to that compound and nobody else. Because if you have the name of the compound, then you can take the name and come back to the formula without making a mistake, assigning it to something else. That hasn't always been the case, but it is now. So it's unambiguous. Also, we don't want to get too wordy or have lots of symbols on there we don't need. So the second condition is that it's non-redundant. We ask ourselves, do we need that extra information? No, we don't. So we don't put it in. Okay, and I'll give you examples of where non-redundant comes in. Okay, we have to meet those two conditions, and we have We're going to start with binary compounds. A binary compound has only two elements in it. That's where we start. And they can either be ionic or covalent. Now, the binary ionic compounds are going to be metals and nonmetals. One from that end, one from this end. The binary covalent compounds are going to be both of them from this end. We divide them into types. Type 1, type 2, type 3. Type 1 binary compound is composed of a metal, and a non-metal. Always. That's the first condition. The second condition is the metal is a fixed charge. When it becomes, and these are all ionic compounds, when it becomes an ion, there's only one possible charge that we can assign to it, no other. So for these metals, they always come from alkaline metals, alkaline earths, and these groups over here. These boron, aluminum, gallium, and indium, they're always plus three. And these three, copper, silver, cadmium. And your there's a periodic table in one of the review document. That one worked. Yeah. Look at those three. Copper, silver, cadmium. What charges do they have? I know silver is 1+. Cadmium 1+. Does it have charges on it?
Yeah, it does. The Ag is 1+.
Yes.
The Cu is 2+.
2+. Okay. So this is 1+, 2+, and I think cadmium is
2+.
2+. Okay. 2+. 2+. 1+. Those are the only charges that they assume. So those two, these guys, and these fit into this type 1 naming convention. And the reason that it's type 1 and fits only in here is because of that fixed charge. If it's a fixed charge, then we don't have to say what the charge is because we know what it is. So if we write a compound, we take this metal and nonmetal, and the metal, we just name the metal. So, for instance, we had this NaCl before, right? And a metal and a nonmetal. We just write sodium. And we know sodium is a plus one charge, always. And we know in ionic compounds, chlorine is always a minus one charge. That's why plus one, minus one, we only need one of each to neutralize. Okay, that's why there's only one. And then instead of saying sodium chlorine, we say sodium chloride. We just change the ending to IDE. That's an example. Now, if I give you a name, can you write the compound from it? Let's try magnesium. Oxide. Okay. We know it has magnesium in it. We know it has oxygen in it. But what's the ratio? Right? Where's magnesium? It's an alkaline earth. Has a plus two charge, always, right? So for convenience, we just write plus two in here so we keep track of our charges. How about the chalcogens? These are minus one, those are minus two in ionic compounds, right? So if this is minus two and that's plus two, that's all we need, just one and one. It's balanced, right? So we went from the name to the compound in this case as a type one, okay? Type 2 is also metal, non-metal. But in this case, the metal has a variable charge. And I don't mean that once it's in the compound, it can change its charge. Right? I mean, as it forms the compound, it could be one of several different charges. possible. But once it's in the compound, it's fixed. Right? So variable charge, they mostly come from the transition metals. Right? You can see that in your table. You'll have a list of charges down here down the side, several of them. Well, not these, but maybe this one and this one. They'll have several possible charges. Those are the most likely. So with a variable charge, we can use this naming convention, right? Metal, non-metal with an IDE ending. But since the charge is variable, we have to say what it is in the name. Okay. So for instance, if we have this one, FeO, how about that? Well, how do we figure out what the charge is on iron? We know what oxygen is, right? Minus two. Right? It's a chalcogen. So if there's only one and one, and you have to assume that that is written correctly, if that's a minus two, then this has to be a plus two, right? Okay, plus two. So now we can write the name, iron. We'll leave a space, oxide, and we have to say what the charge is. And we use Roman numeral. That stands for a 2 plus charge on iron. That's a type 2 compound, the way we wrote it. Now, if I write it this way, iron 3 oxide. Okay, now we got a different compound. We still have iron and oxygen, but now the ratio is different. Oxygen is still a 2 minus charge. So if it's a 2 minus charge and iron is a 3 plus charge because of the name, how do we get that to balance? Right? That's an odd and even. Best way is cross multiply. Use a math trick. Bring the 2 over here and the 3 over here. And then you can check yourself. Right? 3 oxygens at 2 minus each is a total of 6 minus, isn't it? Nobody's agreeing with me. Yeah, if you got 3 oxygen atoms and each one is a 2 minus charge, what's your total negative charge? 3 times 2, minus 6. And then if you have 2 irons at 3 plus each, that's a plus 6. So we're balanced. Okay? That's a type 2 compound. And you don't have to have the charges. Once you get the thing written, the charges are irrelevant. And then, of course, there's type 3. Type 3, let's see.
I've been leaving my slides sitting there. There are examples of type 1s. Notice that all of the metals are from those parts of the periodic table that have fixed charges. Type 2s are just like them, except variable charge. So in this case, if you have CuBr, copper, Br is a halogen, it's a minus one, always. So copper with only one of them, it has to be a plus one. So that's why the Roman numeral one is there. And you can follow that logic for the rest of it. Now, some of these variable charge metals that kind of bleed over this direction. Like iron is typically either plus two or plus four. And indium can be plus one or plus, tellurium plus one or plus three. Bismuth can be plus three or plus five. Okay, so you get some over there too. I'll come back to that in just a second. Type threes.
Type threes are composed of nonmetal and nonmetal. That means that there are no ions. These are all covalently bound compounds, sharing electrons, and we cannot balance charges like we did here. You just have to work from the given formula. And here's how you do it. Say we have this one. You ever had teeth pulled? Okay. Did you use gas? No? Okay.
My kid did then.
If you do, you're breathing that compound. That's nitrous oxide, laughing gas. Okay. But nitrous oxide is a trivial name. It's a past name. The proper name now is to just say how many nitrogens there are using the Greek prefixes, dinitrogen, and then how many oxygens there are, monoxide. Okay? And I think the prefix, the Greek prefixes are, here they are. So just memorize those if you don't already know them. One is mono, two is di, three is tri, four is tetra, five is penta, six is hexa, seven is hepta, eight is octa, nine is nona, and 10 is deca. I mean, they go on from there, but that's all we're going to need. Okay. Let's see. I went too far. Back up. Here we go. Now, if we only have one nitrogen in there, say we had this compound. We don't say mononitrogen if it's the first one. We just say nitrogen because we don't want to be redundant. And then we say dioxide. Nitrogen dioxide would be this one. If we had, say, this one, let's see. Let me give you the name and let's write the compound. Okay, so let's say diphosphorus pentoxide. Notice I dropped the A. Instead of pentoxide, I said pentoxide. It just sounds better. Okay, so we can tell that this is a type 3 compound for two reasons. First of all, we've got the Greek prefixes. Second of all, these are both nonmetals. So we have two phosphorus and five oxygens. There's your compound. Now, if you're trying to figure out how to name a compound that's given to you, say on that extra credit, this is your thought process. Is it a metal, nonmetal, or a nonmetal, nonmetal that you're looking at? If it's a nonmetal, nonmetal, you go straight to the type 3. No questions. And name it this way. If it's not a nonmetal, if it's a metal, nonmetal, then you have to differentiate between type 1 or type 2. Look at the metal. Is it a fixed charge? Look where it comes from in the periodic table. If it's not a fixed charge, then you go to type 2. And you have to insert the charge. Okay, so that's the way you decide how to name the compound. Okay, let me go back. Now, there are a group of ions called polyatomic ions. And we've got a table of them in here that's on the next slide. And the polyatomic ions are a group of covalently bound atoms that function as a single unit, and they've got a charge. So they're polyatomic and they're ions. Okay? So one of the important things that means is they function as a single unit. You can't break them apart. And the charge is not localized on any one atom. It's distributed over the whole thing. So if you have a compound where you have more than one of those in there, in order to express more than one polyatomic, you need a parentheses, like that magnesium nitrate. You have to say you have two of them if you need. Nitrate is a minus one charge. Right? Magnesium is a two plus charge. So we need two negatives to balance that two plus. So you can't change it to two and six. You have to do this because that would be playing with the polyatomic definition. Okay. Now, if you have something like that last one, ammonium sulfate, you've got two polyatomics there. Well, using your convention, is that ammonium in H4 a fixed charge? Yes. All polyatomics have fixed charges. So you treat them. The metal, if they're in the metal position, if they're in the cation position, they're type 1. And fortunately, ammonium in H4+ plus is the only positive ion in the group that I've given. The rest of them are negatives. So the rest of them are going to be on this side. So in that case, they could be either here or here. But the ammonium is always going to be here because it's a fixed charge.
Okay. There's the, it's fine print. But there should be a copy of it in your review document.
I picked that up already.
In your review document, you should have a copy of that polyatomic ion chart. It'll be in the back of it with useful information. Right? And if not on that one, the other one. Not the handwritten, but the printed review document. Looks like a test. There you go. Look at the back at those useful information pages, and you should find a list of polyatomics. There you go. Okay. These review documents have those useful information pages at the back. They will be reproduced on the exam. If you take a paper exam, it'll be on the back just like that. If you take one in Brightspace, then you have that separate document with the useful information that you have to print first before you take the exam. You'll notice that there are columns here. The two columns on the left are identical to the two columns on the right. It's just they're sorted differently. On the left, they're sorted by alphabetical names. And on the right, they're sorted by alphabetical formulas. So the arsenate is toward the top because it begins with an A. It's the top of the other one too because it begins with an A. But it depends on what you're looking for. Are you looking for the name to find the formula, or are you looking for the formula to find the name? Okay. There are some other details that will help you use this document, but I'm only going to come back to it if I have time. Okay, there are prefixes. We did those already. These are all type 3 compounds. Let's see. And this is a decision chart, right? I already gave you the decision procedure. That's the flowchart version. And this one also. All right. Now, there's another naming convention that was grandfathered in. And it came from the Dark Ages, alchemists. And what we've had to do is standardize it and give it some rules and structure. And that's the naming convention for acids. How do you name an acid? Well, first of all, you have to know what an acid is. You have to recognize what an acid is. Acids will always begin with at least one hydrogen. Sometimes two, sometimes three. But hydrogen is the first element in the name, in the formula. Now, there may be other hydrogens in the formula, but those hydrogens do not contribute to the acidity. Okay? A perfect example is acetic acid. Right? Those hydrogens don't count as acids. Only this one makes it an acid. And it's only an acid when it's in an aqueous solution. AQ, that means aqueous. If it's not an aqueous solution, an example, if we have this compound, HCl, and it's a gas, then we would name it, hydrogen is a fixed charge, just like a metal, so we would name it hydrogen chloride. Okay. If we put it in water, now we change it to the acid naming convention. And in order to name it as an acid, we have to look for one other clue. Are there any oxygens in that molecule? No oxygens. If there are no oxygens there, we start the name with hydro. Presumably based on the hydrogen. And then we take this part of it, the chloride part, and we change the I to it. So it's hydrochloric.
asked. Okay? Let's see, another example with polyatomics. If we have HNO3, and that's in aqueous solution, we would name it, if it were not an aqueous solution, we'd name it what? Hydrogen nitrate, because nitrate is this polyatomic ion. Okay, but if we put it in solution, we don't start it with hydro. Why? Because there's oxygen there. We don't say hydro now. Right. So we go straight to the anion, nitrate, and eights become ix. So we say nitric acid. That's it. Okay? Another example using this, homolog to that one, would be HNO2. Right? So the NO2 is not nitrate anymore. It's nitrite. And that will be in your polyatomic list. So eights become ix, but ites become us. So in this case, it would be nitrous acid. Right? Let's see, another one. Another one with a polyatomic that doesn't have a hydrogen is this one, HCN. Right? If you had the gas, that would be hydrogen cyanide, and you wouldn't want to breathe it. Right? You'd regret it for about 15 seconds. Then you would have no more worries. But this hydrogen cyanide, if it's an aqueous solution, right, there's no oxygen. So we take the cyanide and ides become what? Ides become ix. So we say cyanic acid. Okay. So there you have a polyatomic with no oxygen. The vast majority of them do have oxygen, polyatomics. So they would be named this convention. Oh, excuse me. You didn't catch me. It happens. I make mistakes and the students just sit there. No. No oxygen. Hydrocyanic acid. Right? I'd like to say I made that mistake on purpose, just to make a point, but I can't. It's what happens when your brain gets 70 years old. All right. I'm going way over. Okay, acid naming convention. All right, so here's some examples of no oxygen where you start with hydro. Hydrosulfuric acid is interesting. H2S is hydrosulfuric acid. H2SO4 starts with sulfate, eights become ix. No hydro in this one. This one is simply sulfuric acid. So that little hydro makes a difference in the formula. Without the hydro, acid. Without the hydro, you get this one. Acetic acid, I mentioned that one already. This is the acetate polyatomic ion right here. Acetate, 8 becomes ix, so it's acetic acid because there's an oxygen there. And everybody knows acetic acid. If you ever had vinegar in your mouth, that's acetic acid, 5%. And we're gonna play with acetic acid in the lab too, because it's really safe. Now, there are forms of acetic acid that are dangerous. When I was in research, we used to use glacial acetic acid, which is another word for 100% pure. It's just pure acetic acid in that bottle. Two things you don't want to do. You don't want to stick your hand in it. Even though it's a weak acid, it's strong enough at that point because it's pure to do damage. The other thing is, it's organic. You don't want to get it next to an oxidizing acid like nitric acid or sulfuric acid. And this, when they mix, they will react violently. Now, we did have an accident in the lab when somebody accidentally poured spent acetic acid into a sulfuric acid bottle. So we closed the doors and packed the gap with hazmat material. And fortunately, the fume hood was still running, so it vented all the fumes. But I don't know why the tech that was responsible for it was around for a little while longer, but I think eventually they decided that this wasn't their game. They left voluntarily. Okay. Flow chart for naming acids if you're so inclined. Now this one, I'm going to let you do this one on your own. Just use your rules and say which one of these is correct and which is incorrect. Right? You have to decide, is it a type 1, 2, or 3? Right? Metal, non-metal, or non-metal, non-metal. And then go to the metal, non-metals and say, is it a 1 or a 2? And then if it's a 1, then you don't have to worry about the charge. If it's a 2, then you have to put the charge in. And you've got to be sure the charge is right. Okay, so I'll let you do those on your own. There's the answer. That's the one incorrect. And then there's this last slide talks about waters of hydration. Because there are many ionic compounds that when they crystallize out of aqueous solution by various means, some as simple as just evaporating the water and, you know, heating it up at 105 degrees Celsius to boil off the water. Many of them, there's water left behind. And we know that because if we heat them at 150, 160 degrees, they lose weight. And if you want to, you can catch the water coming off of them. So they have waters bound in the crystal structure. If we only heat them to the boiling point of water, then it leaves some water behind. And the example I've used here is the zinc sulfate. I don't have to put the charge for zinc because it's always 2-, no, 2+. Zinc sulfate will, in this case, have waters of hydration associated with it. So how do you name those? Well, you need to know how many waters there are, and you need to know how to name the compound before you attach the waters. So when we say zinc sulfate, then we want a period in the middle of the line, not on the line, but in the middle of the line. And then how many waters are associated with that one formula unit. Right? That one formula unit will have ratio to it 7 waters for each one of these. That's what that means. And the way you name it is, you name this first, zinc sulfate, and then you say, how many with your Greek prefixes? 7 is hepta. Hepta hydrate. Hydrate is the word for water. Hydra is oxygen, and ATE is an ancient term that means water, oxygen. When you put it on the end of the term. So that zinc sulfate heptahydrate, that's how you name waters of hydration in compounds. And you write them with that period in the middle of the line, not on the line or above the line, in the middle. So if you go to type something like this in a report, you got to know how to put that middle dot in there, right? And you could go to the, let's see, what do they call it? The character map. Go down the character map and find your font and find that special character. But that'll take you 4 or 5 steps. Right? So that's why, I did hand it out.
This one right here is known as extended character set key combinations. Now, I'm familiar with the ones for Windows. I've got the ones for Apple products over here, but I'm not sure if they work very well because I don't use Apple. But I put them in here anyway if you want to try them out. If you have an Apple computer, try these and see if they work. But over here, we have a more extensive list. And let's see. I'm looking for a dot in the middle. Okay, I got two types. I got a heavy dot and a light dot. So if you want the heavy dot, you hold down the Alt key, and you have to have a number pad. You can't use the numbers across the top. It has to be a number pad. Alt, and then type in that number combination. In this case, Alt 0149, release, and you should get that dot right there. Just one set of keystrokes. Now, it doesn't always work. So I tried out. The ones on the left are Windows based. So usually any Office product, you should be able to get it. But you may want to go to the DOS based. I mean, y'all are probably too young to remember DOS. That was before we had Windows. It's called DOS, means DOS. It means digital operating system. And you did everything with a key combination. You didn't have a window to work with and a mouse. So it was a steep learning curve. But those extended character set combinations, key combinations, are still in there. And your system will recognize them. Sometimes it'll give you the right figure, right? If you're looking for a Greek letter, like a mu, something like that, try those out and see if it works for you. Because when we do formal lab reports, sometimes you're going to need that. You're going to need those things. You're going to need superscripts and subscripts. Right? Master those for your reports, because that's a spelling error. And we'll talk about the lab a little more next time we meet, because then we'll have that lab time. After we do the review, then we'll go into lab time and talk about how to do this stuff. Okay.